Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Well, yesterday, I went through a ton of scriptures and threw out a lot of information, okay? So what I think I want to do today is I want to go back and start talking to you about each one of those scriptures and mine out why I use those and maybe grow our understanding in those. But before I get started today, so just so you know, I'm going to strategically go in order of the scriptures I used in the video yesterday. And I'll do more than one teaching. I'm going to talk about the salting with fire today, okay? And I'm going to talk about that, and then I'm going to follow through on all the other scriptures and show you the full meaning and the connection between all of those, okay? But before I get started, I want to show you this book. This is such a very good book, okay? I didn't buy the hard copy. I have it on Kindle. I do that a lot. But this is an excellent read. Her Gates Will Never Be Shut. This is a direct quote out of the book of Revelation where we see that people are already inside the new city with Jesus, okay, and that there are people outside the city and these are the people who have not been purified. They have not washed their robes white yet, okay? They're outside the city, but the Spirit of God is saying that come into the city, come and drink from the living water, okay? Now, so let me get started and talk to you about Mark chapter 9, verse 49, where Jesus says that everyone will be purified. And yes, in the literal Greek, the literal Aramaic, it doesn't say believers, okay? That is not what Jesus said. He said everyone will be purified by fire, okay? Now, what I did is I pulled up an article, and I can give you the link to it. And I'm not going to say that I agree with everything on this website or even everything in this little article. What it did is it pulled up everything that I wanted in scriptures that I wanted to talk about as far as the salt. Everyone will be salted with fire. That's Mark 9:49. So I love what he did because he lists some things for us to think about. So I'm just going to read you some things to help us understand. Salt was valuable. Some people even paid with salt. That is where we get the word salary, is from the root word salt. Okay. Number two, salt was connected with healing and purity. Salt water was applied to infections and wounds. It helps heal afflictions of the skin. Newborn babies were washed with salt water, okay? So when we start looking at the word salt, it's important for us to understand that when God says that, or well, Jesus, okay? Jesus says in Mark 9 that people will be salted with fire. It's not a negative thing, okay? It is a healing thing. Let me keep going. Number three, salt was connected with preservation. In the years before refrigeration, salt was one of the most common ways of preserving food. Okay. Number four, salt was connected with flavor. As we all know, now I'm a big salt lover. I use Celtic sea salt that is hand harvested because it has so many wonderful nutrients in it. But salt adds the spice to life. It brings out the flavor in food. Number five, salt was an image for wisdom. Gregory the Great said, now by salt is denoted the word of wisdom. Let him therefore who strives to speak wisely fear greatly. And anyway, that's just a quote by Gregory the Great. Number six, salt was connected with worship and covenant. Now, I talked about that yesterday, that they had a salt covenant, and it was to be faithful to each other and love one another. That's called the salt covenant, okay? And you can see that in Leviticus 2:13, where they had a salt offering, okay? Number seven, Scripture speaks elsewhere of a covenant of salt. He talks about that a little more. 2 Chronicles 13:5, okay? And this is talking about a covenant made between two parties in that particular scripture. Number eight, the use of salt is to signify and ratify what was sacred and widespread. He's quoting here Pliny the Elder. Sacred things are not made without salted meal, whatever that means. I don't understand exactly what he's saying, but the use of salt to signify and ratify what was sacred was widespread. And we do see that through history of all the different covenants and all the different people, okay? Because the reason it was used in covenants is, again, because it was so valuable. Okay, that goes back to number one. All right. Now, it says, to apply the image of salt to the Christian life, we should see that the Christian is charged with purifying, sanctifying, and preserving this wounded and decaying world by being salt to the world. Yes, Jesus said, you're the salt of the world, right? We're salt and light. The Christian, or the followers of Christ, are called to bring flavor to life in a world that is so often filled with despair and meaningless. Okay? Now, I'm going to show you a little bit more. He's got another section here. Everyone will be salted with fire. Two images of salt and fire come together here, but the result is the same. Purification. Remember, I told you this. This is all in our Bibles when we know to look for it. And this is exactly what the book of Revelation, this is what Jesus is talking about. This is what Paul is talking about. This is what we see the imagery of in the book of Revelation. Okay? I want to read to you from 1 Corinthians 3:15. And this is Paul. Paul says, if anyone builds on this foundation of Christ using gold, remember, the refiner's fire purifies gold and gets the chaff and the trash out of the gold. It's purifying. Uses gold, silver, and costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, their work, their deeds, will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to the light. It will be refilled with fire. Do you remember I told you yesterday that the word fire, that Greek primary word is P-U-R, pure, okay? And the fire will test, they used a testing stone to test the purity of gold. That word touchstone or test stone has been translated as torment. They are tormented, and what that word means is they are tested by the test stone every day, day after day. Okay, I've done teachings on this already when I was in the book of Revelation in an earlier portion of my teachings in the series of Hell. Let me keep reading, though. It says, the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire. The fire will test the quality of each person's work. So see, now I want to stop and say this. I know I'm interrupting myself in the scripture, but it's so important I say this. People think that they can raise their hand and say some repeated prayer, I accept Jesus in my heart as my Savior, and no matter what they do, they're all set with their passport to heaven and their get out of hell free card. My friends, what I'm teaching is a little bit harsher than that. Now, I'm accused of being a heretic and teaching falsehoods that, oh, well, people can get away with what they want. No, I'm warning you that no one is getting away with anything, including believers. Everyone will be tested by fire. Jesus said that. This girl right here, okay, I'm going back to yesterday's teaching. My loving Lord, the Good Shepherd, will bring me into the purification room, just like I talked about my five dogs, and some of them are willing, some of them are easy to clean up and make them ready to come into mommy's living room. Others are fighting me and not letting me clean them up very good. You know, they're working against me. Did you know all of us will be purified, okay, so we are kids fit for a kingdom. So, no, I'm not teaching a sloppy agape, everybody gets away with anything. Every single human being will be purified to enter into the kingdom. And it's going to be up to every single person, whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, okay? Including Hitler, yes, even Hitler will be purified. And it may take him the ages of ages upon ages, thousands upon thousands of years. But I want to throw this in. Did you know that the Apostle Paul was a Hitler? Yes. He was genociding all the people who were Christians. He was killing them and having them stoned and putting them in prison. Just remember that, okay? So we all have the potential within our fallen thinking to be brought into evil, horrible acts. Okay, let me finish reading this. Okay, it says, the fire will test the quality of each person's works and deeds, okay? If what has been built survives, the builder will receive a reward. If it is burned up, the builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved as one escaping through the fire or through flames. That's 1 Corinthians 3:15, okay? All right. Now, the book of Malachi, I want to bring this out today. Malachi talks about our need to be purified and salted with fire. See, Jesus is including the Old Testament scriptures in his analogy of everyone being salted with fire or purified, okay? Did you know the Holy Spirit is a purifying fire? Okay, I'll throw that in. That's probably another teaching, and I don't have time to get off on that today. Fire is not always what we think as negative, okay? It talks about God being a burning fire, okay, and his love being a fire, okay? But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be, who can stand? He's saying right here, no one's going to stand. Everybody is going to realize how great and mighty God is. Now watch. For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. Remember the washing of the robes to be white? The launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and purify them like gold and silver. Malachi 3 verses 2 and 3. Okay? And we must all be salted with fire. We must be purified both here in this lifetime and, if necessary, it will be at a later time in the afterlife. Okay? Okay. Salt is good. Okay? And now I'm talking about Matthew 15:3, where Jesus talked about that we are salt and light, and that what good are we if we don't represent him and bring salt, bring purity to the world, okay? We're supposed to be helping God purify the earth, okay? I'm going to skip on down because I want to wrap this up pretty quick, okay? And he comes back around to the part about keeping salt within yourselves so that you will have peace with one another. I've already covered that. That's where Jesus talks in Matthew 9, verse 50, 52, somewhere along in that, from 50, 51, 52, where he's telling us to be in a salt-type covenant with one another and live in peace among ourselves. I talked about that in my video a little bit yesterday. Now, let's see what else have I got for you. I think that's pretty much wrapping up what I want to say today, okay? I want to close with this. Yes, we need to allow ourselves to be salted with fire as a source for us to be prepared to enter into God's kingdom right here, right now. We humble ourselves and give our own will over to Holy Spirit so he can purify us here and now, right? And here's the thing. When we may resist being purified, and we even sometimes may call it or see it as punishment, okay? And if we must call it punishment, we need to call it punishment with a purpose, okay? The purpose of the refining fire or to be purified is for us to become pure, to become children fit for a kingdom, okay? Like my dogs coming into the main part of the house. I have to get them prepared and purified so they can come into the main part of my house. God's focus is not on never-ending retributive punishment, but rather correction and restoration. Well, listen, guys, I'm going to stop right here for the day, and I want to tell you again, I love you, and I thank you for taking this journey with me of us taking God Almighty, our Savior, our Lord. Jesus is the Savior of all mankind, especially those of us who believe. That's 1 Timothy 4:10. Jesus is much greater. The Father is much greater than we've ever given them credit for having a perfect plan and working the perfect plan so that they can accomplish absolute restoration of all things so God can be in all, in everything, in everyone, per our New Testament scriptures, Acts chapter 3, verse 21, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 21 through 28, and all of these things, okay? There's so many scriptures that prove all this out. But I want to thank each and every one of you for having an open mind to study deeper. And let's let God out of this religious box that we forced Him in, and let Him be the Savior of the world. Let Him be the Savior of all mankind. But let's do our part to get people walking in the kingdom here in this lifetime and save them a lot of purification on the other side. Because over there, on the other side, it's not going to be on our terms and it's easy. Okay, guys? I love you and I will see you here tomorrow. Bye-bye.